Well, I'm glad you guys are here with us today. My name is Jim. I'm a lead pastor here, and we're in a series we've been in for several weeks now called Small Things, Big Change. And if you haven't been with us, just do a quick little review of just what we've covered in this series. When we just, you know, kicking off a new year is just a great time just to get a clean slate, a fresh start, just a time to just get our lives focused on the things that God wants to do in us and through us in a new year. And so in this series, we're just talking about how these little small decisions we can make, little small changes we can do, little small thoughts, words that will just bring about big change in our life. So we kicked off this series just talking about having a word for the year, just to focus on something to look at this year through a lens and asking God to help us in one specific area that we can grow in this area. Now, I'm just curious, how many of you have taken time to prayerfully consider a word for this year or a focus? Okay, a good number of you. There's still time to do that if you haven't. We're still in January for another Sunday, so just want to challenge you and encourage you just to do that and just say, God, what is it? What's one area, one thing that I can just focus on this year and allow you to work in my life, the resurrected King that we just sang about, to work in our life to help us to grow and become like him. And it could even just not even be a spiritual thing. It may just be just a physical discipline, you know, to get in shape or whatever. Just one thing that you just have a focus on to go before God. And then the second week, we talked about our thoughts. We looked in scripture. It says that as a person thinks, so we become. That our thoughts determine the course and direction of our lives and how important it is to take every thought captive, the Apostle Paul tells us, to obedience to Christ. And how we need to focus and filter our words and our thoughts through the lens of the Word of God amidst all the noise, all the junk, all the things that we're bombarded with in this information age, to use God's Word as a filter as we spend time with Him and in His Word so that our thoughts become God's thoughts. We tap into God's promises, the things that He has for us, so that that will determine the course and direction of our lives. And then last week we talked about your words. How our thoughts become words, and how the outflow of the heart, the mouth speaks, and how God, when He created everything, God spoke and brought life into existence. And God created us in His image to speak in a way that brings life. And we just talked about how asking, do we give life-giving words when we speak, or do we give life-taking words when we speak? And so just these small little tweaks, these small little changes, if we can work these into our lives, they will bring big change. And so today we're going to take it one step farther, and we're going to talk about your habits or your disciplines. Okay, so I'm going to probably step on some toes this morning, but we're going to talk about your habits, and I just want to bring up this next phrase that we have here. This is what we've talked about every week. Just a reminder that it's the small things, okay, that no one sees. It's often all the little decisions, all the little things we do behind the scenes that no one sees that result in the big things or the big changes that everyone wants. So what we do on a daily basis, on a weekly basis, on a monthly basis, on a yearly basis, those little things that we do can bring about big changes in our lives. And they will radically, if we get a hold of these things, especially at the start of this new year, where God just gives us a fresh start, it'll radically change our lives. It'll radically change our relationships. It'll just bring the kingdom of God alive in us when we just go to God and just bring these things into focus. So today we're talking about habits, because our habits or disciplines in our life are what we repeatedly do. All right, our disciplines, our habits are the things that we repeatedly do. I remember John Maxwell. He used to be a pastor, and now he's a leadership guru, and he's been a leadership guru for a long time. And I just remember this phrase he would say. He said, if you always do what you've always done, you'll what? You'll always get what you've always got. Okay, now that could be good or bad. So some of you, you know, you've got good habits in your life. So if you always do those same disciplines, they result in good things. But if we got some bad disciplines and some bad habits, and if we never really make any little tweaks along the way, if we always do what we've always done and we want change to come about, guess what? We're always going to get what we've always got. So somewhere along the way, we got to bring about some change in our life, and that's what God is all about. God wants to change us. He wants us to become like Christ. Okay? Now here's the good news. We dive into Scripture, and today we're going to be in the New Testament the whole time. So if you have your Bibles, you can first off open up to 2 Timothy. It's near the end of the New Testament, 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7 is where we're going to start off. And then we're going to dive into a little bit of Romans chapter 7, and then we're going to be in 1 Corinthians and then Hebrews. So we're going to jump around a little bit, but we're going to be in the New Testament. All right, so that's near the end of the book there. So in 2 Timothy, the Apostle Paul is writing to a young pastor, a young apprentice. And it just seems from what Paul writes to Timothy that Timothy is, he's looked down upon. He feels like he's looked down upon because he's young and he's probably a little insecure and he's a little timid. And so Paul just challenges him with a lot of things, you know, to be disciplined, to just be in the Word of God and to study the Word of God and just to be bold. And this is what he writes in 2 Timothy 1 verse 7. He says, "For God has not given us a spirit of fear and timidity," okay, so not to shrink back and allow everything external around us to dictate how our life goes, you know, because of fear, what someone might say, someone might think, something might happen, but rather, he says, but what God has given us is a spirit of power and of love and what? And self-discipline. Another translation will say self-control. It's the same thing. That God, the resurrected King, as we confess Christ as our Lord and Savior, the power that rose Christ from the grave is alive in us as believers. And Scripture tells us that God hasn't given us a spirit of fear and timidity and weakness, but he's given us a spirit of power. That same working power that rose Christ from the grave is alive in us. So that we have love, the love that God wants us to have, so that as we looked at last week, we can speak words that are life-giving. And he gives us a spirit of self-discipline to help us in the midst of our weakness so that we can accomplish the purposes of God and God can do things in us and through us as we allow him to work in our lives. So this is the good news, is that God has given us a spirit of love and of power and of self-discipline to accomplish the things. So today we're going to kind of work on getting in shape, start off with a silly video. You know, you guys ready to do some running today? All right. Or would you rather eat candy bars and pretzels and drink a Coke, right? I mean, that's kind of where we end up, right? So today we're gonna tap into just getting into shape, all right? And so I was just ask some questions here. So how many of you would say that you're a highly disciplined person? I mean, you have lots of habits and you're very disciplined. How many say you're highly disciplined? There's like two people raising their hands. Well, how many would you say you're not so disciplined? All right, you know, that's, you know, honestly, it's okay, we're in church. You know what? That's very common, okay? We are not, most people are not highly disciplined people. But I want to just kind of respectively challenge you to say that you're actually more disciplined than you realize. You know, and I talk to people and they'll share, you know, it's like, well, Jim, you just don't understand. You know, it's like, this is how my day typically goes. I wake up, you know, and my alarm's going off in the morning, you know, it's time to wake up. And I just reach over with that annoying sound going, and I reach over and I hit the what? Snooze button. How many of you hit the snooze button every morning? Some of you are like, no way. Others are like, yeah, man, I hit that snooze button. Now, let me ask you, how many of you guys hit the snooze button at least 5 times before you get out of bed? All right, I mean, how many of you use your cell phone as your alarm? All right, how many of you are still using the old analog annoying? All right, yeah, we still have one of those too. All right, so the snooze goes off, you know, and you just go over and you hit the thing after the alarm's going off, hit that snooze button, you lay there, you know, and sometimes they're like incremented like 5 minutes. I think the iPhone is like 8 minutes, you know, and so another 8 minutes goes by and then it goes off again and you keep reaching over. Then you're kind of running a little bit late because you hit that snooze button one too many times, right? So then you get up and you run downstairs or you run into the kitchen, grab a quick bite to eat, and you didn't have time to make your lunch. Like, well, I'll just get something at lunchtime. So then you run off to work, and you're really grumpy, you know, and you're racing through traffic, yelling at people, showing them symbols that you shouldn't be showing them. And, you know, and then you get to work, you know, and you're there. And then, you know, the morning's going well, but then it's lunchtime, and you're hungry, so you got to go out because you didn't have time. So you go out to lunch, and you've been really trying to lose weight this year, you know, and so you drive by, and you see there's Panera, and they got some really good healthy food, but there's this heavenly golden arches that's just glowing there in the middle of everything. And so you go through the drive-thru and you just don't get a healthy meal. You supersize, you know, and you get your quarter pounder with extra cheese and you get the big extra supersized drink and the extra fries and you totally blow, you know, eating healthy. And then you go back to work. And because you ate all that, you're a little sluggish. You know, the afternoon you want to just take a nap. How many of you think America workers should take a nap in the afternoon? I mean, they do it in Europe for crying out loud. You know, and so you're really tired and you're not very productive. And so then what happens is you have to stay over a little bit longer. And then you really, you know, your wife's texting you, it's like, are you coming home? Or, you know, husband's like, are you coming home today? It's like, well, you know, because I stopped at McDonald's, you know, I was really sluggish, took a nap and I'm behind. So you stay a little bit late. You get home, things aren't going well. The cat's coming up against you. You're kicking the cat off. The cat goes and claws the dog. The dog goes and bites your wife. And it just becomes a mess for the whole evening. Right? And then some of you guys, you're so worn out, you go sit down and you turn on the TV and you get out your video game and you start playing video games to help lull you to sleep, right? Now, let me just suggest in the midst of, is that how everybody's day typically goes? Maybe not exactly, right? Maybe I'm exaggerating a little bit. But let me just say that in the course of every day, you actually have disciplines and habits that you do on a regular basis. For example, how many of you made time to get dressed this morning? Thank you, Jesus. Things would be a lot different this morning. But you actually made the time to get dressed. Now, how many of you just have to have your cup of coffee in the morning? You know, so you made sure that you took time to get your cup of coffee. How many actually made coffee before you came? I mean, you're just like, you get up. Okay, so you had the discipline. You had the time to go and do that. See, you've got lots of habits. How many of you brushed your teeth this morning? All right, see, you guys have all kinds of disciplines in your life and habits that you do on a regular basis. It's just that there's some times in life where we want something that we haven't made into a habit yet, and it hasn't embraced that discipline that we really want. So I'm just going to kind of give you a working definition of what discipline means, okay? Up here on the screens, it says this. Discipline is choosing between what you want now and what you want most, right? So you know what I'm talking about. There's those moments where it's lunchtime and you're going to go through the drive-thru and there's all the options that are out there. Which one are you going to choose? So we always have these options that are there to choose between what I want now or what I want most, that it's going to hold me to long-term, sticking to my habits, sticking to my discipline to get the big things that I really want, right? So little small decisions I make in the moment are going to have a huge impact down the road, all right? It's like saving money, okay? You put it away in a long-term saving plan, a little bit at a time, and over a long period of time, it accrues to a lot, right? It's the same way with our health. Okay, if we just do a couple little things in our life over a long period of time, it's going to have big impact on our health and our spiritual health. If we just do small little things, rather than hitting that snooze button maybe 6 times or 7 times, maybe we only hit it 2 times to buy us that little bit of extra time to get up and spend a few moments connecting with God in His Word. Working that into our life just to let God and the Spirit of God breathe into maybe our sail to give us the wind of the Spirit that day to radically change the course and direction of our day. Allowing God to breathe into us and speak into us and allow the resurrected King to come alive in us, who has given us a spirit of power and of love and of self-discipline. And how those few little moments that we make a different decision will radically impact you. It'll impact your marriage. It'll impact your relationship with your kids. It'll impact your entire life if we're just willing to make small little changes, small little decisions that will result in big changes. The question is that we always wrestle with is asking this question up here on the screen is, why am I so inconsistent? You ever ask that question? Why am I so inconsistent? I mean, I have all these things that I really want to accomplish and I really want to do, but for whatever reason, I just can't seem to get there. We're going to look at what Paul he kind of taps into this a little bit, what he says in Romans chapter 7, and we're going to be reading through verses 15 through 25. I'm going to skip a couple of verses in there. It's a very long text, but I'm just going to highlight just some of the key things that the Apostle Paul addresses here in Romans chapter 7. So this is what Paul writes. Verse 15, I don't really understand myself. Remember last week we talked about talking to yourself? How many of you ever said that to yourself? I don't really understand myself. It's really bad for me because I'm a pastor and there's a certain expectation of what I'm supposed to be like and how I'm supposed to act. And I remember years ago, I'm just going to pause here for a moment. Years ago when I worked with an engineer and he had this phrase, and I'll never forget it. He said, some days you get the bear and some days the bear gets you. And there are days where the bear is all over my back. And I'm sitting there trying to shake this thing off. And it's like, I don't understand myself. Why do I keep letting that bear get on my back and pulling me down? And Paul writes here, he says, I really don't really understand myself, for I want to do what is right, but I don't do it. Instead, I do what I hate. I say things and I act in ways and I do things that I just wish I could go back and do it over again and make it right. Paul says, I don't understand myself. Picks up in verse 18. He says, I want to do what is right, but I can't. I want to do what is good, but I don't. I don't want to do what is wrong, but I do it anyway. But if I do what I don't want to do, I am not really the one doing wrong. Whoa, 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 hold on a second, Paul, then who's doing it? And he says, it is sin living in me that does it. Okay, let's pause here for a second. This is what Paul's saying. He's saying, this is the tension that we live in on this side of eternity. In Christ, when we have faith in Christ as our Lord and Savior, we have salvation in him, okay? The reality is that even though we have salvation now, we haven't experienced the fullness of it or the consummation of it. We're still on this side of eternity in this frail, sinful flesh suit that we carry around with us every day. But in Christ, we have the Spirit of God working in us, okay? And then we have our sinful nature that's still at war in our members, luring us, and the bear jumps on our back sometimes and is pulling us down. And there's this tension that we wrestle with every single day. It sabotages us so many times. And he says, this is what's going on inside of me. Verse 24. He says this, he says, oh, what a miserable person I am. Who will free me from this life that is dominated by sin and death? And then he gives this incredible statement. He says, thank God, the answer is where? The answer is in Jesus Christ, our Lord. That is the good news of what Christ has done for us that we just got done singing about. Because of Jesus' willingness to leave eternity and to come down and pour out his life on a cross for our wrongs, he has defeated sin and death. And now we have the power of the resurrected king alive in us that by his power, by his spirit, he gives us victory to overcome the struggle of this flesh. We have victory and power in the name of Jesus. Amen. So God gives us the ability to be self-disciplined and to overcome this inconsistent struggle that we have, that we go through every single day, week of our life. The key is whether or not I'm going to reach over and hit the snooze button one more time, or whether I'm going to tap in to the power of God and allow him to work in and through my life. And give him the first word. And give him the first time, the first moment of every day to allow him to breathe in me and give me that spirit of power and of love and of self-discipline. And so these small little changes that we all wrestle with, we need to come and make these decisions and choices like, okay, God, I need my thoughts, I need my words, I need my entire life, my habits to line up with what you have in store for me. So that the things that I want most, I can accomplish through Christ, as Paul says, I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. And that's the hope that we have in Christ. The challenge that we have is trying to make those decisions into habits that we can do on a regular basis. Because oftentimes what happens, we start our new year off, it's like, man, I'm going to get in shape this year. I'm gonna get on the treadmill or the elliptical, you know, and just get in shape. So when I'm running, you know, I'm not drinking a Coke or eating candy or grabbing my bag of pretzels, but I'm going to get in shape. And so what happens is we start off on Monday, it's like, okay, you know, and we get our 30 minutes of aerobics in, running on whichever machine you run on. We're feeling really good. Tuesday comes along, we get up, we're going at it again. Feeling really good. It's like, man, I feel good. I did it twice, you know. Wednesday comes along. Oh, getting kind of old. My leg didn't feel quite the same. It's like, yeah, maybe I better just give it a break, you know, for Wednesday. Thursday comes along, and maybe you work out. You know, like we have a workout area not in our basement. It's just cold on Thursday, and it's just really too cold. I'm not going down there. So you skip another day. Friday comes along. It's like, you know, it's like, I'm not getting up for this. I'm just worn out. And then Saturday comes and it's over. And all of a sudden, you know, like I shared in the first week, those New Year's resolutions we make, by this time, by the mid-end of January, 50% of them are already over. And so somehow we got to tap into the power of God and say, God, help me. Help me to take these small little times, these small little decisions, these small moments, and choose what's best. Get the right disciplines in my life. Get the right thoughts and the right words and the right habits all lined up, God, so that this year can be a different year. This year I can experience the power of God alive in me to bring about change in my life, that it'll change everything around me. Okay? So this is the things that we need. Years ago, it was 12 years ago, I turned 40. And I went into the doctor for a physical. I'm thinking, you know, I'm getting a little bit older. Maybe I should go get a physical and get some blood work done. Everything was great, except my cholesterol was a little high. The doctor says, let me prescribe you some pills. And I was like, hold on, doc. I'm not a big pill popper. You know, it's like, I would, if there's another option besides taking pills. And he says, all right, let me prescribe you with some CoQ10. It's an enzyme. And exercise. If you would exercise every week, things would go well. Let's just come back in a couple months and see how it goes. So I went and I just radically changed my diet. Most of you have been, some of you have been around me. I became a vegetarian, primarily vegan. All right. I'm weird. It's okay. We're church, right? So I became a vegetarian. I changed my diet, radically went on a strict diet, began exercising at least 3-4 times a week, just on a regular basis. And in 2 months, I lowered my cholesterol almost 100 points. All right. Now, it doesn't work for everybody, but thank God it worked for me. And so now the challenge is trying to keep that going. You know, I actually lost weight. I lost 10 pounds and I was hit a little less here than I do now. But, you know, and then when you figure out how all these different foods you can eat and get around it, you know, it kind of comes back. But when you discipline yourself, it was one of those things where there's these tensions that come in life. Okay, and one of those tensions is now, Proverbs says, sometimes it takes a painful thing for a man to change his ways. Now you got this thing staring you in the face. What am I going to do? Am I going to change my lifestyle so that I can live a little bit longer, hopefully, if I don't get hit by a truck or something? You know, if I can live a little bit longer so I can be with my kids a little bit longer, all because my cholesterol is high? Am I going to do that, or am I just going to keep doing the same bad habits over and over? And so I said, okay, God, I need help with this. I am not a disciplined person. Would you help me by the power of your spirit to be disciplined to do this? And I've consistently done that for 12 years now, okay? By the grace of God, I've been able to still maintain being a vegetarian. Yes, I would love to sink my teeth into a big Whopper from Burger King with the grease pouring out of it and just grab a handful of fries and supersize Coke because for whatever reason, it tastes really good. It does, but I've chosen not to. Do I miss it? A little bit, maybe here and there. But the bigger picture is what I'm after. Now, let me just ask you this. I asked you earlier, how many of you say you brush your teeth every day? All right? Now here's the thing. This is an interesting statistic. Do you know that in the early 1900s, most Americans did not brush their teeth? Do you know why you brush your teeth? Now, this is interesting, okay? Back in the early 1900s, there was a guy by the name of Claude Hopkins, and this guy was an incredible marketer. And he figured out that he could sell people on anything to make them believe things, to sell a product more than other products. And there was one beverage company that did the same process that every other beverage company did, but they marketed it and said, hey, we steam clean our bottles. That's why our product tastes better than our competitors. And that company skyrocketed in sales over all of its competitors. And so this guy who came up with this toothpaste called Pepsodent, he came up with a brilliant idea and came to hang out with his buddy Claude to market this thing together. And he said, hey, you know what? Most people just cannot stand this nasty paste that they put in their mouth. So we've come up with an idea. We're going to put a little bit of mint oil in there and some other ingredients, and then another kind of ingredient that's going to make it sizzle in your mouth and foam up to give the sensation that it's making your teeth clean. All right, now it does clean your teeth, okay? But the problem is that you have to make it a habit. So what they discovered is we can just put a little bit of good flavor in there and a little bit of a sensation in your mouth and then market it. Hey, you can have the Pepsodent smile with a clean, fresh, minty taste. And Pepsodent sold millions. They made millions of dollars off of that product. And then other manufacturers jumped on board and did the same thing. And all because of that little marketing scheme and that little change, America started brushing their teeth. Isn't that crazy? And so what it was is that there's this film that would get on people's teeth and, you know, they just drink water, whatever, switch it around, whatever, and or just let it be there, you know? And so they say, hey, we can solve that problem. But what happened was is that as they studied it later, is that as long as there's some kind of craving that's filled, we will do it and form a habit. And I want to say we've got something way better in Christ than clean teeth. That God wants to do amazing things in us. He wants to experience the fullness of all that God has for us in Christ. That's why he left eternity to come and pursue us. He wants everything about our lives to be incredible. If we're just willing to tap in and to just him every day and get into his word every day and begin to build this habit, knowing that the end result, 1 year from now, if I choose every day that I'm going to get up and spend time with God, maybe use your phone. I was just talking with somebody this past week and I said, man, I love YouVersion. There's so many cool things on YouVersion, so many free devotionals and things that you can just get on there. And they just help. You can even set reminders. Hey, you haven't spent time with God today. You can partner with friends to keep you accountable all on a free app. We have access to the most incredible technology today to help us grow spiritually, more than any other nation on the planet. And yet studies show that most American Christians are biblically illiterate. That's sad. When we have all of the information and all the technology and all the resources. And so what we've got to do is we've got to figure out, maybe you put a little bit of mint oil on your Bible, you know, and you get up in the morning and that's where your toothpaste is. And you're just like, so you fall in love with this thing, you know. You know, just something to help us form a habit so that sometime throughout the course of the day, we're going to stay connected with God. And that the craving that God has in store for us is to have transformed life that is so incredible and what God has for us. So what I want to do is just in this last part of this morning is just look at how to live a spirit-disciplined life, all right? So we're going to do a little training this morning. So I want everybody that can stand up. Ramona, you can stay seated. You don't have to stand up. But everybody that can, stand up, all right? If you have a little one, you can stay sit down. All right, this is what I want you to do. We're going to get in shape this morning, okay? I want you to just kind of start jogging in place, all right? I want to hear you guys huffing and puffing. All right. All right, you guys tired? All right, sit down. All right, you can sit down. You're good. I know you were hoping for 20 minutes, you know, so you can say, yeah, I got it done on Sunday. All right, so I just want you to think. We are in training for running the big race. Okay, the big race is coming, and Scripture has a lot to say about this, and we're going to look at a passage in 1 Corinthians 9. But when it comes to the first thing, number one, how to live a spirit-disciplined life, Paul tells us this. We need to run to win. All right? We're running to win. We are not running to place. We are running to win. First place is the only option, okay? In Christ, that's what we're running for. We're running to win the race. The goal is the finish line. We're running towards the finish line to finish well. This is what Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 9, verses 24 and 25. He says, "Don't you realize that in a race, everyone runs, but only one person gets the prize? So what? So run to win. All athletes are disciplined in their training. They do it to win a prize that will fade away. But we do it for an eternal prize." I mean, they're doing it for some little trophy that's going to corrode and rot and rust, you know, and fade away. Or back in the day, there was a wreath that was just going to decay. But Paul says, what we're running after is an eternal prize, that someday we're going to be with Christ in eternity, in all of his glory. And so it's important that we run this race well so we can finish well. So when we stand before God, we can hear him say those incredible words, "Well done, my good and faithful servant. You did small little things that made a huge difference in your life and in the world around you. You went and you changed the world because you were committed to the small things. And it made a huge difference." So the goal is to run to win. We're running it to win. We are all in this race for Jesus. The second thing, number two, is this. Not only do we run to win, but we have to run with purpose. Okay? Why do you brush your teeth every day? Just because you like that mint flavor? Don't think so. It's nasty. I mean, sometimes it's not very good. You just for the sensation. Oh, yeah. No. We do it because we want our teeth to last, right? We want it to last, so we do it every day. So we need to run with purpose. We need to be intentional in walking with God. If we made a decision for Christ, then it's just not a decision. It's a lifestyle, a journey that he's called us into. There's all kinds of expectations that God has for us in his word because of what Christ has done for us. And so we need to run with purpose. This is what Paul says, 1 Corinthians 9, 26 and 27. He says, not only do I run to win, he says, so I run with purpose in every step. Every step. I am not just shadow boxing. I'm just not there in a room all by myself just pretending. No, we're in a real fight. We're in a real race. This thing's for real. And he says, I discipline my body like an athlete, training it to do what it should. Now, that's a big statement right there, training it to do what it should. The challenge is, as we see in Romans, is that we have this sinful nature. The bear is on us many times. If we're not tapping into the power of God and getting his word into our lives and asking the Holy Spirit to come and live in us and breathe in us, then we're not tapping into that power of love and of self-discipline to help us to grow and becoming like Christ. That'll change everything in our lives. We need to be intentional in every step. It's okay. You know, my wife hits the snooze button all the time. It takes her a while to wake up. But you know what? She makes sure she gets up every morning to spend time in the Word and with God. So it's okay to hit the snooze button. Maybe set it a few moments earlier. So you get up, and when the moment your feet hit the floor, the first thing you grab is your phone with a Bible app, not Facebook. How many of you check your Facebook status every week? Let's be serious. Let's be honest. How many of you check your Facebook status or your Instagram, all right, Snapchat, whatever it is? It's a discipline, right? We always have time for things. It's just getting the right thing, so we have to run with purpose in every step. And then the last thing, number three, is this. When we run with your eyes fixed on Jesus. You have to have a focal point. If you always do what you've always done, you're always going to get what you've always got. And so if you're running your life and your eyes are always fixed on Jesus, then the results are going to come out of that. We have to have a focal point of how we are running. And the fixing our eyes is key, that it's fixed on Jesus. And this is what the writer of Hebrews tells us in Hebrews chapter 12. Now let me give you a little bit of background behind before we get to Hebrews 12. Hebrews 11, if you read in it, Hebrews 11 is called the Hall of Faith. Okay, it's like, you know, the Super Bowl is coming up and there's all these people that are being inducted into the Hall of Fame. They were outstanding MVP players in their careers, okay? And so Hebrews chapter 11 is tapping into the same thought, And they're saying there's all these men and women of God that have gone before us, that have just tapped into the power of God by having faith, convinced that God was able to do what he said he would do. And they went before us. And so the writer of Hebrews is painting this picture that it's Super Bowl Sunday. We're on the field. We're getting ready for the big game. It's getting ready. Kickoff time is coming, and we're ready to play the game. And in these stands around us are all those that have gone before us who finished well, holding on to their faith in God. And then he picks up in chapter 12, and this is what it says. Chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. He says, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses, he's talking about those in the grandstand, witnesses to the life of faith, let us strip off every weight that slows us down. Let's just pause here for a moment. Let us strip off every weight. You see, in the ancient world, when they would, in the first century, when they would run these competitions that they would have in these games, you know, if you're running and your clothing is kind of weighing you down, you know what you would do? You'd strip it off. You just, whatever was holding you down, you just strip it off to run the race. And sometimes they would just strip down butt naked. Now, let me tell you, if you do that, you want to make sure you are first place. All right? That's a bad image. Okay, so there are some things, what the writer is saying, there's just some things in our life, like in this race as we're running it, that are just holding us back. They're weighing us down. They're keeping us from running effectively. It doesn't have to be a wrong thing or a bad thing or sin. There are just some bad things in our life, habits, okay, or distractions that weigh us down that we need to strip off so that we can run effectively. It doesn't have to be bad or sin. It just could be something that's just, we need to say, you know what, I just need to change my habits and quit doing this thing. It's okay to do, but it's just not helpful. Paul says all things are permissible, but not all things are beneficial, okay? Some things just need to stop making time for and make time for the better things, okay? He says there's things we need to strip off. Then he says, and especially the sin that so easily trips us up. So there's two things. There's things that just weigh us down, and then there's sin sometimes we just get entangled in, and we're trying to run, and we get tripped up along the way. And Paul says to stand and to stand again. You get tripped up, you fall down, you know what? You get back up on your feet and you tap into the power of God. Say, God, help me to stop falling into that bad habit and just to keep running so I can finish well. Okay? That's what the writer's saying here. He's comparing it to this race that we're in. And he says, this is how this happens. And let us run with endurance the race God has set before us. Not the rat race that the world has set before us, but the race that God has set before us. And we do this by keeping our eyes on Jesus, the champion who initiates and perfects our faith. He's already run the race and completed it. He poured out his life on a cross, and it's our model of how to run. There's sacrifices we need to make along the course of the way. These small little decisions will bring about big changes in our lives if we're just willing to tap in to the power of God and allow a new habit to set in, knowing that the outcome is going to be so incredible in my life, in my marriage, in my family, in the workplace. It'll change everything over one small decision to attain the fullness of all that God has for us in Christ. So I just want to leave you with one last question, and that is this. What habit do you need to do now to experience the big change that you want most? And I want you to take a moment and think about that. And this is what I want to do just in closing. I'm going to ask the band to come on up. Is that laying up here on the front of the stage are a bunch of gold medals. And on each one of those gold medals, there's a star on one side and it says winner on the other. And in Christ, each and every one of us are in this race to win. No second place. We're in this race to win. And so somehow there's got to be something that's going to help us to run the race well so that we can finish well. And having those reminders that are just there in front of us, what I want to encourage you to do in a moment here, I'm going to pray. And when the band begins to just to play and lead us in worship, I want to encourage you to come up and grab one of these gold medals and then go back to your seat and just prayerfully consider, what is this one habit? Maybe you've already got good habits in your life, but what is one habit that you just want to trust God with? And you know, if you want to, you can take it home and just write it on there. But I want to encourage you to be redneck and hillbilly and ghetto. And I want you to take it and I want you to hang this on the rearview mirror of your car. Okay? So you can drive down the road like this. That's my medal. I won. All right? Or maybe, you know, if you don't want to do that, you can hang it on the corner of the mirror in your bathroom or on your refrigerator. So every day when you get up, it's a reminder of the race that you are running. And you're not running for second place or third place. You're running to win in Christ. Amen?